Yes.
Yep.
No, you can't. You can all hear me. How are you? That was
good.
A good question.
Good.
Thank you so much for coming tonight. And I think you're going to really enjoy the program that we have set up for you. And when I say we, I'm talking about some wonderful organizations that have come together around this topic of who were we here in Waterbury when we celebrated life here in the city, and particularly where we are right now in downtown Waterbury. And I'm talking about Connecticut Humanities, and I used to be a board member on the Connecticut Humanities Council, a wonderful organization that has done such remarkable work. And in fact, they were collaborators with Connecticut Public Television on that documentary about the town green and what it has meant and signified in the history of Connecticut towns and the way they've been organized. And the Silas Bronson Library, our host tonight, and of course Rachel Guest, will be a big part of this program, and then the Urban Studies Group at UConn Waterbury. So wonderful collaboration. Thank you for coming, and we make it as interesting for you as we can. So welcome you again, and this is Scott Lons from Connecticut Humanities, and we welcome you, Scott, to Waterbury.
Oreos was a good enticement as well, so I hope you all enjoyed some food while you're here. My name is Scott Lons. As Larry said, I'm the manager of grants and programs at Connecticut Humanities, and on behalf of all of us, I just want to thank you for coming out tonight. For those of you who don't know, we are the State Humanities Council. Every state has one. We're the state affiliate of the National Endowment for the Humanities, and at the state level, we're helping people explore, learn, think about their communities. We do that through grant making, through programs, and through collaborations, like the one we're doing tonight with both Rachel and Silas Bronson Library, Henry Glasser, and UConn Waterbury and their Urban Studies program. It's a program that has some grant funding on a federal level from the National Endowment for the Humanities. We got a grant about a year ago to do programs in 5 communities looking at race relations, and race relations on a variety of different ways. This one is looking at race and place. And as you saw in the flyer and some of the advertisements, who's been in Waterbury over time, where these groups come from originally, when did they come here, how did their movements change, and then this is kind of a precursor to a program I hope that you'll come back and join us to a week from now, same that channel, same that time, looking at where we might be going from here, and specifically what kind of development do we want in Waterbury, and even more specifically around the town of Reach. So thank you for coming. I want to turn it over to Rachel and have her welcome on behalf of the library. So thank you all.
Well, welcome to the Silas Bronson Library. Quite a few familiar faces, but maybe some new faces as well. The library actually has been part of downtown for 147 years now.
Wow.
Very long time. This is our calculation. The third building, if I'm remembering correctly. We actually started out on the green before we moved over here, and that's a whole huge thing. I think Phil Benevento and I could probably talk to you for hours on end over the whole history of downtown. We'll try to keep brief from that. If you haven't had a chance already, the exhibit behind us are all historic images of downtown Waterbury in approximate chronological order. Some of these are images from the Matatuck Museum, which of course you would expect to have historic images, but quite a few of them are actually from our archives. We have a tremendous resource that's been sort of underutilized. A lot of the images coming from the Parks Department, which kept really wonderful scrapbooks year in and year out. So there's a lot of different resources at the library other than what you can see here. So thank you all for coming, and I will hand it all back to Larry.
All right. Well, I just want to say that since I signed back on as a radio host in Waterbury in 2002, I had developed a feature called Way Back Waterbury. And I would do it on an occasional basis, but the outpouring of calls was remarkable over a 14-year period. The memories and the passion associated with the city by people who grew up here stands in stark contrast to the image of Waterbury by those outside its borders. It's as if we're talking about two different worlds. Without fail, Each caller's walk back through time will find them in their distinct section of the city, whether it's Waterville, Oak Overlook, the South End, Brooklyn, the North End, Town Plot, Bunker Hill. And yet that journey would always end up where we are tonight, in downtown Waterville. It was truly our commons. It was where we hung out, where we shopped, where we celebrated major historical events, where we became less parochial in our thinking as we mixed and mingled with those going to trade school or college prep, or those from rich or poor sides of town. And for so long, it was where our highly productive workforce spilled onto the streets as their factories emptied out, ringing the downtown as they looked for transportation back to their neighborhood, their special place. The program tonight will endeavor to look back at who was here in an historical romp through our city, and will be followed next week, as Scott said, by a look at who we are becoming here in the city of Waterbury. To discuss who exactly do we envision we are building Waterbury next for. And there is that slug line that has been promoted as part of the promotional materials, be here. Well, who do we want here? And these are hard questions because Waterbury, of course, has some dramatic demographic and economic changes that are well underway. Tonight, we'll look at immigration patterns, the various ethnic groups who have called downtown Waterbury home, the impact of urban renewal, and the changes wrought by deindustrialization. So we know who our sponsors are. They are a wonderful group. And today, we will now get an historical look at the city. And we have two wonderful people to present that to you. Phil Benevento, the longtime city historian, just retired. And of course, he's been getting a lot of attention in the Republican American recently. He was mayor of the day, the Italian mayor of the day, and was just inducted into the Waterbury Hall of Fame. So we congratulate him, of course, for about 35 years. He was a teacher at Carleton High School and ended his career as chairman of the English department there. And then, of course, Rachel Guest. Now, this is not easy to get a laudatory editorial from the Republican American. That's tough. And she's done a great job at the Silas Bronson Library after some difficulties here. And we're seeing some of the changes that are going on during her administration of the library. Such an important and changing resource in our city. So they'll start us off, and then we'll introduce you to the rest of the panelists. Thanks again for coming tonight, Bill.
Well, the irony is that the center of Waterbury was never intended to be the center of Waterbury. The first settlers who came here from Farmington, 32 strong, crossed the Naugatuck River and climbed up to the neighborhood we know as Town Plot. And they were put under the General Court in Hartford. They were told to mark out 8-acre properties on which they were to build their homes and so forth. But this was 1674. At that time, there were Indian outbreaks, and King Philip's War, Chief Metacomet, was much feared by these 32 lonely proprietors from Farmington. They had no fort house, they had no protection, they were probably living in caves, and they decided, let's get out of here. So they went back down, crossed the Naugatuck River, returned to Farmington, and then came back in 1677, and they said, we're not gonna keep crossing that river every time we turn around, let's settle someplace else. And that someplace else is our downtown commons, center, green, however you wish to call it. And they built their homes around it. So who were the first people? The first people were 32 English Puritans. That was our first ethnic group. They built their commons. They were members of what became the Congregational Church. The church that they eventually built, the first one in 1702, stood about where the clock on the green stands now. And it had no windows, and it had no seats. So it was not too accommodating. As time passed, they built further churches. They built a second one, and then a third one about where the course on the green is, and then eventually moved off the green, but always near it. So even the Congregational Church that exists today is only a few steps from our green. Now, if we go back to those early days, Waterbury was dirt poor. These people thought there was going to be rich soil. They would be able to grow whatever they wanted. Yes, there was about 2 inches of rich soil, and everything else was sandy under it. So it was hard, very hard life for them. They thought there would be all sorts of minerals in the Naugatuck Valley. They could make themselves wealthy. There weren't any. So here they were. What did they have going for them? What would help them to survive? And the only natural resource of consequence that they had was water. And there was power in water. And it was water that would help to drive the mills that would make Waterbury famous. And so they were known as the village of Manitow, named for the Indians of the area, in 1674. But when they got their, when they were established as a town, a legitimate town, the Puritans changed their name to Waterbury because of the force of water, excuse me, that we had in our town. At that time, Waterbury was not the Waterbury of today. It included Plymouth, Thomaston, part of Middlebury, Naugatuck, Prospect, Woolcott. It was a huge land area. Slowly those areas moved off to find to establish their own towns. And the reason, I think, being mostly because it was so hard to get to church during the winter time. So they got what was called winter privileges. And those winter privileges meant they could have a church in their area. And so the psychology began to dawn on them that maybe we should be separate. So within this valley, we have a fulling mill, we have a grist mill, we have early mills, some of them right where Stovall's is, right on the Mad River, which at one time was called the Mill River. And then from there, they began to produce products however they could, from buttons to pins, and they began an industry that was to grow improbably, okay, from a small little town that became a city in 1851. It was only 5,133 people living in Waterbury. By the time we reached 1900, 50 years later, there's something like 75,000 people living in Waterbury. And so the great change was the growing industry, the immigrants coming across, beginning with the Irish and Germans, who worked in the factories, and the housing that was developed was always close to the factories. And the factories were not that far away from the center of the city. So the center of the city truly was the center. It was a commercial center. It's where people shop, but it was also where people lived. And many of those stores, storefronts you have, the apartments up above, they were people housed in those apartments. And there were streets that no longer exist, like Canal Street, where people lived in tenements and so forth. So it was a bustling, rough city with hot factories, with no safety devices whatsoever to help and protect you. But from out of this smoke and steam and turmoil, it grew a very wealthy, prominent industrial sector.
I feel like we could have a, we actually get a couple of historians going. We got Ruth in here, we'll bring in Jeremy Glasser, we just have a whole, Jeremy Brecker. As Phil was saying, the immigrant populations were coming here for the factories, because there was so much work here. And the first group, the first large group were the Irish, specifically the Irish Catholics. And this was a Yankee Protestant town. So there was a lot of pushback. And when you go through the histories, you do find records of the Irish not being welcome, having difficulty purchasing property in downtown for their church. There was took a lot of effort, and it took some of the established Protestants helping them in order to establish themselves. One of my favorite stories is actually John Monaghan's memoirs, Pleasant Institution, where he talks about the construction of the Immaculate Conception Church on the Green as a statement by the Irish Catholic community that they had finally arrived, that they were now contenders in Waterbury. So you had the Congregational Church on one end, you had the Episcopal Church on the other end, and in 1921 you finally had the Catholic Church right in the middle. The Germans, that, you know, that's actually something I'd love to look further into, because there was a very strong German community, strong German population, but World War I had a big impact on that. Starting with World War I, it wasn't popular to be German because the Kaiser was the bad guy. And of course, as we know, World War II also became very negative to be German. We have a ton of these different groups coming in. One of the things that I love about Waterbury is that people lived together in the neighborhoods, whether in apartments downtown or in other communities. Certainly you have neighborhoods that have become associated with different groups. The Lithuanian community was especially strong in Brooklyn. But there's a lot more of the blending and exchange of cultures in Waterbury's history than I think that you will see elsewhere. In the work that I did, just going through and pulling up all of these images, one of the things that I was looking for were faces of all of the different groups that have been in downtown. And it wasn't easy. Most of the photos actually show either people who appear to be white or people who you know are Italian, because the Italians became very quickly in the 20th century one of the largest groups in Waterbury. But when I went to the photo from VJ Day at the end of World War II, and that's up on the wall, the green is just wall-to-wall people, mostly young people, cheering in celebration and excitement, and it is a completely mixed group of people. It's really tremendous seeing that. And then what I found images I already knew existed, and what I put together, and that's something that I've never actually heard anyone talk about, is the fact that there were Japanese Americans who were resettled right here in Waterbury during World War II. And that's a story that I haven't heard before. It's something I came across online in an archive in California. And that's a really, really fascinating story that I'd love to learn more about. The businesses downtown, I'm trying to keep it short. One of the other things that I think is really key for understanding the history of downtown is the nature of the businesses that were here. Right now, we'll get more into this next week at the next program, but right now a lot of the attention is focused on, can we get Starbucks to come into downtown? Can we get Chipotle to come into downtown? Can we get these big name brand things to come into downtown? Well, that's not what downtown ever was. Downtown was always a mom and pop shop sort of place. It was always all of these different immigrant groups and the children of the immigrants starting up their own stores, starting up their own businesses, and businesses that remained in a family for generation after generation. And that was always what downtown business was all about. I think that the changing point was when the Naugatuck Valley Mall was built. I think that was a major, had a major impact on downtown Waterbury. It's part of a whole car culture that emerged in the middle of the 20th century. Everybody had a car, they wanted to be able to drive to wherever they wanted to go. And so we lost all of these businesses to the mall. Grassmill Mall opened 30 years after the Naugatuck Valley Mall. And again, there was sort of a sucking effect on downtown. downtown, much worse than what we have today, where everything was falling apart, nothing had been maintained. Some of those buildings are gone, but the ones that are left, many of them have been beautifully restored. So there's a lot that's happened. There's a lot of potential, but that's next week.
Past
today, and I will stop there.
Thank you. As you know, we go to a reunion, and this is something of a reunion. Many people from Waterbury and coming back into the city, and the person who's come the farthest tonight to be with us from Southbury is Sherman London. And Sherman London, for so many years, a reporter and the editorial page editor for what was then the Waterbury Republican, the Waterbury American, now known as the Republican American. And I just learned tonight that he's still editing. Now, the Pomperog Woods newsletter, so he never stops. A vibrant 95 years of age. Sherman London.
Grants, the 5 and 10, here because the big store was on Bank Street, approximately across from, it was on Bank Street, and you could go in the store on Bank Street, and there was a long staircase, and you could go down that staircase and leave the store on South Main Street. Sugenheimer's was there. Some of the other major stores on Bank Street. And Bank Street, I think, was the number one selling abode for the stores of Waterbury. Some of the Minicucci's, high-grade men's stores. Knapp's, another big store. And let's see. Then just below the economic status of Bank Street was South Main, where there was the Rose Shop, Engelmann's, which sold only children's furniture and clothing. And everybody who had a new infant had to go to Engelmann's to get furniture for the house. Hertzmark for all kinds of shoes, Friedman's, A&L was down there and later moved onto Bank Street. Now, I have to tell you a story. At the corner of South Main and it was Grand Street that came down. There was a men's clothing store operated by Sam Siegel. And everybody I knew just wondered, how does he make a living? You never see a customer in a store. Well, one of the stories that I think my father told me was when a customer would come in and he wanted to buy a suit, and they'd say, well, what size do you wear? Well, he didn't. The customer didn't know what size suit he wore. So what Sam did, he put a paper down on the floor and he said, lay down on the paper and I'll measure the paper. And that's how he found out what size he was. There's probably no other store in the country with that kind of reputation. On West Main Street, the big one was Forrester's. That was a little later being built, but it was a higher grade women's store only. And I remember Forrester was the state senator, and I covered him when I was covering the General Assembly. And I remember my wife wanted to buy something, so we went down to Forrester's, and she was doing business. Some clerk came over and didn't pay much attention to her. And then I saw Mr. Forrester. Oh, he said, hello, Sherman, and we chat. And the clerk changed completely. She was then very concerned about what my wife wanted. On East Main Street, there was Muslim Liebeskind, and there was a men's store, and I cannot remember the name of it. But I remember I used to get suits there when I was young, and I think I even got my first tuxedo there for Crosby graduation.
Sullivan's.
Now, we all talk about Exchange Place. Well, Exchange Place got its name because that's exactly what it was. All the trolley cars from north, south, east, and west, and the buses from all parts of the city all came down to Exchange Place, and there you could change from one line to another. I think you did it in free. You just got to pass from one to the other, and you could go around. And at the corner, I think it's still there, is Bobby's Corner. It was just a little newspaper stand, and they sold some fruits and vegetables there too, as I believe. One thing that happened in Waterbury that may be a little bit unique was a lot of the downtown stores, not the big stores like Holland Hughes or Green This or those, but a lot of the others were operated by Jewish owners. And when the high holidays came in the fall, they shut the whole store down. They put ads in the paper saying, we are closed for the high holidays. Happy New Year to everybody. And I don't know that that happened in a lot of other cities, but it certainly attracted, it made a position for Waterbury that was distinguished. Okay?
Wonderful. Street, and what a beautiful little avenue that is. Well, let's get a perspective from Reginald Beeman. And Reggie, of course, was a state representative for many years, just a gentleman who could have been in my business very easily. But Geraldo Rivera, I learned tonight, kind of aced him out of one job, but such an articulate and thoughtful guy. And he is the director of Opportunities Industrialization Center. And it's always great to hear Reggie's perspective. And Reggie, maybe you bring a different perspective growing up here in Waterbury. And that's what tonight is all about, sharing all of our different memories.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank all the sponsors of this forum this evening. Everyone's already said almost everything I was going to say. Phil talked a bit about where people lived here, Canal Street, which was blown away actually in the flood in 55, and Railroad Hill Street, another area where it was blown away, devastated actually in the flood of 55. Rachel discussed how families lived together and in various communities and how they had rumors actually. I'll get into that in a second. Sherman London brought back so many memories of downtown. Even I worked in Kresge's in high school. And it was a very nice place to work, and there were so many people. But I would like to give you a different perspective as a black man in Waterbury. And what we came as 1917. Prior to the start of World War I, my grandfather came to Waterbury, checked it out, and kind of liked it. He was a driver. I don't even know what kind of trucks they drove back then. In North Carolina, he was probably the first black man to drive a truck for the city of Elizabeth City, North Carolina. And the money wasn't there, so he had some friends up here in Waterbury, and they were in the factories that everyone has discussed already. So guess what? After World War I, he came up here, and now we're celebrating next year 100 years. Our family's been here in Waterbury. And you mentioned Sammy Siegel.
Yeah.
All right. My brother Sam, the cop, the retired cop, he's named after Sammy Siegel. Okay? That's what my mother told me, and I don't think she would tell him. But it was not easy. We're here to talk about downtown. And one thing that I discovered in the research that I've done and the many oral histories which go on in the black community is the fact that we had our own separate life up in the North End. It was only a couple of blocks from downtown. Everything that we needed, and at one point there was a credit union there and a bank. We had a dentist there, we had gas stations there, a few movie houses, the Alhambra, and the one on the North Square.
Power.
The Carroll Theater. Yeah. Go in there for a quarter and stay all afternoon. So some drunk took a, I'm serious, drunk took a bottle of Muscatel and hit the screen, and that was the end of that.
Oh, anyway, wow.
For 25 cents, we would stay in the Carroll Theater all afternoon as kids. But we did have our own community at clothing stores. Many of them were owned by some of the owners downtown, and they brought about an uptown. We even had an area, which I just found this out, that when the young white kids would get out of high school, because downtown was a buzz with activity. All the high schools were here. Worst thing we ever did was put the high schools on the periphery of the city. But anyway, when that would happen, white kids would come downtown, and the black kids had a hangout up in North Square area. I just found this out, and I understand it was owned by a reverend, but I won't tell anybody's name. But anyway, it was very, very, very difficult. Another thing, you mentioned Holland Hughes. We didn't eat at Holland Hughes too much. One time when black people would come downtown was for a few things. The pencil box giveaway at the State Theater. Everybody came to the pencil box giveaway at this old State Theater. My mom was in the State Theater on Pearl Harbor Day, she tells me. And the second thing we came downtown for was to get on Santa Claus's knee at Holland Hughes. Other than that, we were up in our own community. Obviously, when we came to schools, the schools were downtown, whether it was Wilby or Crosby or Croft. And that was all the interaction. We knew everybody in all the various communities. Larry talked about his way back to Waterbury show with Ronnie DiOrio, P.J. Conway, and Norm Vitelson. See, 95 too, right? Ron DiOrio, his dad was a plumber. And he used to love teaching me how to pitch. And we broke a couple windows on the street we lived on. And you know, my mom didn't like that too much, nor did my dad. But we knew each other. We knew each other. Young people, if they went to Sacred Harbor Catholic High, we still knew each other. That was the beauty of, even though we lived in different areas, the beauty of it is we knew everyone, and Waterbury was a great place to be and to grow up. Whether it's listening to WWC or WA Tarago, WBRY, we had a good community to grow up in. It's interesting you mentioned urban renewal. My first real job out of college, I served as a relocation specialist for Waterbury Urban Renewal. And when you start with the church that used to be next to the old Waterbury Savings Bank, that church, when you come all the way up, almost up to Cherry Street, and then back over, we relocated over 3,000 families out of there, and about 40 businesses out of there during urban renewal. So that really decimated the North End, and it took the economic engine. A lot of people call it urban removal, but it took the economic engine out of that North End. And obviously with the car and strip malls, downtowns, not only in Waterbury, they have to redefine who they are. And one thing about the redefinition is that everybody will be a part of it. So I thank you again.
Next week we're going to be looking at what that future of the downtown will be, and we encourage you again to be here next Thursday night. Well, I know everyone on this panel, but I just met tonight Magdalena Maggie Campos. She is an attorney for the state of Connecticut, and she grew up in Waterbury. And I must say that this panel really comes by the way of a lot of energy from a lot of people, but Dr. Ruth Glasser has done such a great job of introducing us to so many people, and we look forward to hearing from you, Maggie.
I'm just blown away by all the stuff I'm learning tonight. I'm so glad to be here. Obviously, you have a different perspective. I'm a little bit younger. I still have a lot of gray hair, so I'm a little bit younger than the prior speakers. Well, sorry. We came up from the Bronx. We had come up with families to visit a couple of summers, and my mom fell in love. We were in the Bronx. She had six daughters, one son. She had gotten divorced. She was Dominican, did not have any family here, but she had the church. She had the Pentecostal church. And when she came up, she was like, oh, the peace, the quiet. I was like, where's everybody? I was just hanging out in the stoop in the Bronx. I'm like, there's no people here. And where are all the cars? And where's the subway? You know? And I was mortified. I'm the eldest of the seven. And I was like, Mom, no, we can't go up there. She's like, this is going to be the best costume. And we had to come up with it. And we moved up, I believe it was 79, because I was 16, in 1979. Actually, it was right after the blackout in New York, and there was all the riots and everything. She said, we're up. And I'm like, okay, whatever, that's all. But maybe 15, maybe it was 78. And I came up, and it was very interesting. I had started high school in New York, in Manhattan Vocational Technical High School. I was going to be an architect at the time, and I was doing architectural drafting. And I forgot who, somebody told my mom, she needs to go to Keener Tech, and that's the Vocational Technical High School. Well, there was no architectural drafting. All of a sudden, I was in mechanical drafting, drawing. I went from rendering houses and drawing gaskets. I was like, what is going on here? Why are, this is why we died? And, but that was, you know, that was the industry at the time, and tool makers, and that's what they were preparing the kids for at Keener Tech. And that was not my cup of tea. So then I quickly just moved into my district school, which at the time was Kennedy High School. And that was another experience. Now mind you, when I went to Keener Tech, there were very few girls there. They didn't have their sewing and their fashion at the time, but I was used to that because I was one of three girls that met in Tech. So that was fine. That was not a culture shock. That was fine for me. I go to Kennedy, and I'm like, where are all the brown people? Thank you. So then everybody's like, you're Puerto Rican? No, I'm Dominican. What's a Dominican? I'm like, what's going on here? There are no Dominicans. And we had come with a Puerto Rican family, but did not realize that actually Dr. Glasser had done a wrote a book, and my mom's featured in that. We were the second Dominican family to move to whatever, Connecticut. And we were, we knew the first family was the church, because we remember some of these things, but nobody knew how to make them for, so that was very interesting. And trying to educate everybody and just say, no, we're not Puerto Ricans. No, it's not the same thing. Yes, we speak Spanish. Talking about the Republican American, when I first said to a teacher, I was Dominican American, she said, you're from the Republican American? I'm like, from a newspaper? This is a teacher. I want to go back to the front. But same kind of stories back then still. Downtown was a big hub. My mom felt actually safe enough for us, to the older three girls, to kind of just, you know, come downtown. And we lived at the time on Cherry Street before it kind of like got cut up and we were behind there. And we just walked down and go, I think it was Kresge's. I think that there was still questions at the time. But go there, we did a lot of shopping. In the Bronx, we were used to, you know, buying the produce on one side, the meat on the other. So my mom was a little bit flustered, but we adapted very well. And it was nice just to be able to be out and see the friends. This, at the time, Kennedy, the schools were already out, you know, to where they're at now. But we still all came downtown. I remember the summers having a lot of activities in the green, a lot of activities for the kids, and concerts and stuff, and different things that, you know, especially free things because we were poor. And we were participated. The library itself, obviously it was pre-internet, but they also had a lot of things for the kids and free activities, and so we spent a lot of time here. Coming down here, and just a lot of walking we did, and we were able to participate in a lot of things. We also went to colleges. And one thing about that, I don't know who mentioned the ladies, at the other ladies, they always remembered your name. It was amazing, but you know, one of them always called me Magdalena, and I was like, you call me Meg, and they're just like, I'm going to call you Magdalena. Okay. But they remembered your name, and I liked that. They came down for the doctors. Everything was down here, and in we were kind of in between, not just because we were the only second family, Dominican family here, but also it was difficult because we weren't white, we weren't black, we weren't Puerto Rican, and at that time it was very divided, you know, the South End, the North End, and we were kind of, and it's funny that we lived in Church Street, because it was kind of like in the middle, and it's still close, so we were like, we want to be friends with everybody, but it was interesting, and when it started going to Sagrado Corazón, Sacred Heart, where they done the merchant with Sacred Heart, but Santa Cecilia, was the, and Father Blackwell. Yeah, it was Cherry, before Walnut.
Scopus.
No, now. Originally, it was done on right on Cherry Street. It's like a little house. And the bottom of Walnut Street. So we would go there because it was just close to there. And so we got introduced to a whole another host of people. Some of them would live a little bit farther in the town. So, but everybody came down to the church, and we congregated in the church. But I think that's one of the biggest things that we miss. I had an opportunity to recently, when they closed the Danbury Juvenile Court, where I was working, to come down to Waterbury Court. I was here for a year, and now I'm in the new Toronto courthouse. And walk around a little bit and kind of just, oh, and another thing we remember is from St. John's Church, because they gave up St. John's for this holiday. So we would always make that line and go down there, and that was part of it. We'd go to Halloween's, but then we'd go down to St. John's Church. That was one of a big thing for us. But thank you.
Some of my great early memories as a professional finally getting out of college were in downtown Waterbury. We did the first Easter City Telethons in the state of Connecticut down at the old Holiday Inn, and that was wonderful. And then we did things like dance-a-thons for Easter Seals at the old CERA, and I had only about 40 people show up, and I had about 100 people who were signed up. We didn't have a lot of money, but we had to nurse this event for 24 hours. That was a tough one. But I'm only telling you this because I want to preempt our next panelist, because he's likely to tell you a story about something else we did in downtown Waterbury, which was a tribute to Rosalind Russell, where Bob and I really got to know each other, particularly me, under a lot of pressure. We thought we would get Rosalind Russell to come back to the city at the State Theater. She didn't come back. Then she was going to give us a video. She couldn't. She was ill. We finally got an audio. But I will never forget Jay Clark, who was one of my predecessors on Talk of the Town. And he was our host. And the Jimmy Dorsey Orchestra was late getting in from Long Island. And he said, you go out there and tell them that. He did not want to have anything to do with something that was going awry. So there's three of my wonderful early professional memories in downtown Waterbury. That by way of introduction for Bob Doerr, who was a volunteer for us that day, has volunteered for so many duties here in the city of Waterbury, and of course what he's done with the Waterbury Veterans Committee is just remarkable as the historian in many ways, and somebody who's kept so much together. And I learned recently that he also was the author in a very short stay in our state senate of the Lemon Law here in Connecticut, so we congratulate him for that. And of course, he's the director of the Frigo Housing Development Corporation, and just a wonderful guy, Bob Doerr.
Thank you very much. It's true that Larry and I met in the 20th anniversary of Rosalind Russell's epic world premiere, 1975. Larry comes to the Civic Theater of Waterbury, where I was the house manager, technical director, and the person responsible for ensuring that nobody gets killed on the stage. Now, you may think that's funny. No, a stage house is a dangerous place. There are literally tons when you're dancing on those boards, there is tons of material hanging over your head. By ropes, with sandbags, pig iron, slides, lighting electrics, all kinds of stuff. So, but Larry and I did get to work together, and we became good friends and will remain friends through the years. It has been said that a logical fallacy can be created by taking facts and mixing them together. So, how can we create that logical fallacy for Larry here tonight? We can say, we could say that Rosalind Russell was invited to return to Waterbury in 1975 by Larry Rifkin. Rosalind Russell declines to return to Waterbury in 1975. Rosalind Russell sends a tape to Waterbury, where which we played that evening, an audio tape, greeting the people from Waterbury. 3 months later, Rosalind Russell is dead. Sad but true. Larry had nothing to do with it. he didn't go to the other side. But seriously, I come to you, to you tonight as one of the direct descendants of one of the first Irish Catholic settlers here in Waterbury. My maternal family arrived in Waterbury in 1840 from Abbey Lace, Queens County, Ireland. Basically, Waterburyans, Irish Waterburyans, Irish Catholic Waterburyans, because that's what they all were, came from two areas of Ireland. Queens County and which is now known as County Louth, and the other county is called County Kerry. And there was always a competition. If you died, if you were a Waterburyan and an Irish Catholic and you died, either went to Mulville Funeral Home, which was the Kerry men, or you went to the Queens County, the Queenies, which was the Bergen family. So my family arrived in 1840, took it, Fintan T. Phelan. Fintan Thomas Phelan was born in 1798 in Abbey Lace, a small village about 40 miles west of Dublin. Came to Waterbury and prospered very well. Purchased 5 acres of land, according to the deed, more or less, from Doris Baldwin on the north side of what's, and the deed says, the Turnpike, which I presume right now is Baldwin Street. So he purchased 5 acres more land. And what he did, he made his fortune by dividing that 5 acres of land into building lots. And 1 month he would sell one month. And as people arrived from Ireland, he sold them building lots, helped them with the house. And he died in 1894. And he has one of the largest monuments. You know he was well-to-do because he has one of the largest monuments in Old St. Joseph's Cemetery. So when you see that, that's all the Irish judging, you know what I mean? You got a big monument, you are doing well. The family in 1930s, upon the death of his daughter, who was the beneficiary of his estate, and she was quite wealthy, the 3 daughters and 1 son all inherited a large portion of what was the Phelan estate. So the Phelans that had married the Dowlings and intermarried with the Leahys and all the Irish, and then moved up to Willow Street, which was called the actual street was called Cheston Avenue. And Cheston Avenue these days looks like Beirut after the bombing. In those days, it was quite a nice place. The mayor of Waterbury lived on Cheston Avenue, and it was really a nice place. That's the street I grew up in. So since 1840, the first house was built on Ridge Street. They sold that, and they moved to Cheston Avenue. I sold that house in 1978, and I purchased a house on Concord Street. And then recently I sold that. And moved. So in about 160 years, I think we've moved three times. So we're not exactly what you would call gypsies. But it's a great place. Waterbury's been a great place to grow up in. As our family prospered here in Waterbury, they went into government, they went into public service. My great uncle, Fintan T. Phelan Jr., served in the state senate. My cousin, the Healy, served as chairman of the Judiciary Committee for many years as a state representative from Waterbury. And I was able to follow that tradition serving in the state senate in the 1980s. I first worked downtown Waterbury. My first job was working at Miller & Peck's for Maurice T. Harmon. Frank Harmon was the manager. Family friends with, it's, of course, it's always, he's not who you know, it's, well, it is who you know. So the Harmons were good friends with my mother and father, and they hired me to work at Miller and Beck. And they also had an elevator operator, Paddy Crane, an old Irishman from Waterbury, but he was actually born in Queens County. And so he was a Queenie, and anyway, it was a great place to be from, I really did enjoy it. Working downtown Waterbury at Miller & Peck was really too much fun. Across the street we had the little luncheonettes, we had all the shopping downtown. It was a great, something we really are missing now, and it was touched on earlier, the great Jewish merchant class. It was stunning. And it was made possible by federal regulation that was adopted during the 1940s and 1950s. It was called the Fair Trade Laws. And no one mentioned that, mentions that today. If you wanted to buy a pair of Levi's in the 1950s, 1960s, they were $4.50 or $5, wherever the fair trade price was, everybody sold them for the same price. And the abolition of those fair trade prices caused the collapse of the merchant class, in my view. That's what, and I saw that as really a big problem. The shoes were fair traded. If you wanted to buy your Buster Brown shoes, they were $12.99 wherever you went. And that supported many, many families here in Waterbury and throughout the nation. So nobody had mentioned that previously, but I think that was a big problem, that when those fair trade laws were abolished, all of a sudden the large merchants came in, undercut the smaller merchants, and it was lights out. It really was lights out. But anyway, it was really, I'm so pleased to be able to be here tonight to just share a few of my thoughts growing up here in Waterbury. Fulton Park, stunning. We had so much fun in Fulton Park. The ice skating in the winter, and back in those days there were signs on the green telling you there was about 10 or 12 different skating areas throughout the city of Waterbury. Certain parks would be flooded by the park department, it would freeze over, you could go ice skating everywhere. And there were signs on the green, skating here, Hamilton Park, no skating, Fulton Park, skating Water Park, and so on and so forth. Murray Park would be frozen, they would pump that water into Murray Park and freeze it for the kids in the winter. That is something that I would really like to see a return to. I think it's really helpful to get people out of the house and interacting with one another. Another thing that we had here in Waterbury was the Burt Connor Little League Stadium. Burt Connor was a local merchant, an insurance salesman, who gave a large sum of money to create the Little League franchise here in Waterbury. And it was located behind where Frankie's is on Watertown Avenue. It has now been filled in by a connector to Route 63, but was the finest little baseball stadium you would ever want to see. I happened to play second base for the Red Sox team that played over there. My namesake, Bobby Doerr, played second base for the real Red Sox, number one. He is in the Baseball Hall of Fame. So it wasn't, I think it was more destiny than choice. But it was a great place to meet so many other families playing baseball on Watertown Avenue. The Merck Connor Stadium, it was just a wonderful place to grow up. Sacred Heart High School, I graduated from Sacred Heart High School in 1967. We were state champions. We played East Catholic High School, which is from Manchester. East Catholic High School is on a little river called the Hockenham, and I still remember the cheer. You ready? Yeah, no, you can. Kick 'em, sock 'em, throw 'em in the Hockenham. Go Hearts! So, anyway, thank you so much for being here.
It is who you know. I thought we were going toward Harvey Weinstein territory. Sherman, why don't we get you up here with the panel? Because what I'm going to do is ask a couple of questions, and then I'm going to turn it over to all of you to talk about your memories and ask some questions. And then we will conclude this program at around 7:45. So what I would ask is that every panelist take a very brief moment to respond to these questions, and we'll just pass the microphone down. How's that? I'd like to ask, what was in your mind during the era that you really remember downtown Waterbury, the most important public event to occur in downtown Waterbury that gathered so many people for a civic activity?
The only thing I can remember is going to the movies every Saturday afternoon.
Yeah.
I can't remember any events of any consequence.
Well, I remember the Kennedy, and I think that there were about 40,000 people. And I went down with two friends, and Bobby Siegel, who had cerebral palsy, and he had to stand on crutches, and my friend Al Vickis, who has since passed away. And we waited there until I think it was almost 3 in the morning. And finally, he appeared on the balcony, and the crowd rushed forward. But where they were rushing to, I don't know. He was on the balcony of the Hilton Hotel. But my poor friend Bobby was just dragged with the crowd. I found one crutch in one place, one crutch in another place. And finally, I found him. But he was standing. That's what I
remember. I'm going to answer, even though I can't say I remember because I'm and actually didn't even want to be. But, you know, looking at it from a historian perspective, the gatherings on the green during World War II for the bond rallies, World War I for the bond rallies, VE Day, VJ Day, those are the times when you see those photographs of masses of crowds, and of course, Kennedy's visit. And you know, speaking in terms of someone who's been in downtown for a near 20 years, I'm gonna bring it up to you here and now, and my absolute favorite is the gathering that happens every year in Library Park. That is just unbelievable. Thousands and thousands of people from all over Waterbury coming together. Really just fantastic.
Thank you. For me, the number one event that happened downtown Waterbury would be the arrival of John Kennedy in 1960. My mother was a polio survivor, and as such, she wanted to get there early so she could get up front. And so my mother, my father, myself, made our way downtown around 6:30, 7 o'clock, and stood right at the edge of the green and waited and waited and waited. And of course, Milton Berle was there, and there was all kinds of people that were trying to keep the crowd occupied. But around 2:30, quarter to 3 in the morning, it was a roar and lights coming up South Main Street, and you could hear it. And it was like it was an electric shock that traveled through the crowd. And everybody was saying, he's here, he's here, he's here. And he made his way to the front of his motorcade pulled up in front of the altar. He made his way in, up to the top of the balcony, and it was really an electric moment for all. And of course, you know how it ended. He won the election. He blamed it on Connecticut. And Pierre Salinger said it was the greatest night of the campaign. In his book, Making of a President, 1960. So for me, that was number one.
I concur with that, but I think number two was when he returned. He did come a few days before the Cuban Missile Crisis, and I remember that because we drug a young man out of the crowd as well, and we ended up at St. Mary's Hospital. The guy is James Saunders, the undertaker here in town. They kind of ran him over. We were all kids, and we just got him out the crowd and ended up going up to St. Mary's Hospital. Also, my youngest brother was in St. Mary's Hospital. He had broke his leg, and he swears up and down that the motorcade came by Franklin Street. I don't know why, but he swears up and down that Kennedy waved at him.
Whatever parade, we all came down, you know, and just be part of it, and again, just enjoying all the multicultural food. And so I do concur with what she was saying about the gathering. I think that's it's very nostalgic for me because it kind of reminds me of those things.
Matt, keep the microphone down. I think they can hear me. If you could bring back something to this day, 2017. That you remember from your experiences in downtown Waterbury and preserve it, what would that be? I mean, if there's one thing you could bring, or a store, or just a a sense of place, what would it be?
I think it's difficult, but it's that the small businesses that you can't get that same quality in big malls or department. But I think they're just going, I don't remember all the names, but remembering just going into these places that they're constantly, they remember you, and they're part of your family and your community. And I live near Tumpah, so we have a few of those there. But I just think that bringing that part of that and helping the small business owners in downtown.
I never had a chance to go into the Coney Island Lunch, which is across the street from Hadley's, but it used to smell so good as a kid walking by there. And the interesting part, I started discussing how black people basically came through downtown, but according to some of the old timers, they supported the Coney Island Lunch. And I always wanted to go there, never did. Be with my mother and dad and going to Hadley's across the way, and I always would smell the hot dogs, but they made sure we ate before we left home, so we didn't have to spend any money. But I also would like to segue back a tad to what I was speaking of when my grandfather came. One thing about the neighborhoods and families living together is that one would tell another, and then another would tell another. And after a while, when houses were purchased, you would have a three-family house with maybe 10 families living in there because everyone was coming from one area of North Carolina here in Waterbury. And it was interesting to watch them all get ready to go pay a bill downtown. Bob mentioned a fair trade, but we also know that many of these stores made sure that there was a carrying charge. And then Wirtz would always say, there's no carrying charge, which was a little interest.
Thank you. One of the things I would like to see brought back downtown Waterbury is one of my favorite joints on East Main Street. It was called Mel's Bar. Mel's Bar had a back door that opened to behind the State Theater, which was the Civic Theater of Waterbury. And whenever we would have a bus and truck show from Broadway, the back door of the stage house opened right into the back door of Mel's Bar.
Wow.
And it was the most fascinating place to listen to stories. We were in Cleveland last night. You wouldn't believe the crowd. Have you guys ever played New Haven? I mean, it was just one story right after another. And I love listening to these men and women who live their life on the road, going from one town to another, performing a bus and truck show of My Fair Lady, of Oklahoma, of Greece, or back in the day we had 1776, the Broadway show that traveled around through the United States of America. And Mel's Bar is where they all ended up. And the beers were 25 cents and a bag of peanuts and they were good to go. It was really a delight, so thank you.
Dressers to come
down. Dressers especially, but all of there's be so many restaurants, so many lunch spots. I even managed to get at least one lunch in at the I guess you'd be fair call it a diner in the basement of Helen Hughes. All of those little hole in the wall, great little restaurants.
When I think of downtown, I think of the hustle and bustle of downtown. People came in as to exchange place and all sorts from all parts of town to do their shopping and so forth. And I was a little boy going along with my mother. We'd have to get off the sidewalk because there wasn't enough room to stay on the sidewalk. And there was a festive side to it. It was very uplifting. It was exciting. Especially for a little kid like me.
I have to remind you about one thing. In Waterbury, if schools were closed because of the weather, there was only one way to find out. Every factory in the city blew its whistles exactly at 7 o'clock in the morning. And if you heard a factory whistle blowing at 7 o'clock in the morning, go back to bed. And the other thing, I didn't mention the Kennedy visit to Waterbury. I covered that from start to finish. And
he was a star of the documentary.
Yeah, well, what are you going to do? Okay.
Let me ask, if you were to pinpoint the one element that brought down downtown to a point where now we're at a critical juncture for restoration, what would you say it was? What elements of change or social change really changed the nature of downtown Waterbury?
I think it was the redevelopment program. And Waterbury is unique probably in the country because we had a referendum on whether to have a referendum about building some redevelopment. And the then Mayor Bergen was absolutely opposed, and we were much slower getting any development downtown Waterbury than all the other major cities in the state.
Well, it's not an easy question to answer because there's many things that contribute to that decline, the less that site was going. But I think one thing that hurt the city was people, middle class flight to the suburbs.
I'm going to blame them all again. But not just, I mean, in a broader context, the economic change in consumerism, the way that we shop. First, it was the malls that everyone wants it all to be in a single building, and now it's online shopping, and which is taking everything out. That's a real change that it's difficult to convince people to go to a mom-and-pop store, to go to a store where the owner is there all day long. I know a lot of the few stores that are left like that struggle because people can get it all for cheaper elsewhere.
One of the things that I think that has really contributed mightily to the demise of downtown was, honestly, urban renewal. Difficult choices were being made. People thought that newer was better, but in fact, it would have been easier to restore the old buildings. One of my good friends, Colonel Francis X. Bergen, his wife Kay Bergen, created a nonprofit here in Waterbury called WATCH, Waterbury Action to Conserve Our Heritage. The plan for urban renewal for Waterbury was to take it from Grand Street all the way over to the Green. That was all scheduled to be demolished, including our beloved Howland Hughes, Center Street, everything was gonna go. Francis Bergen, Colonel Bergen, decided to, with his wife Kay and several other individuals, sued the city of Waterbury in federal court and got injunctions stopping urban renewal from continuing its march all the way over to the Green. There would be no downtown Waterbury if it wasn't for Colonel Francis Bergen and his wife Kay Bergen, both of whom have since passed. The WATCH, W-A-T-C-H, Waterbury Action to Conserve Our Heritage, stopped that urban renewal dead in its tracks. You can see part of what they saved on, I think it's Bank Street, where Diorio's is now. Those few buildings were boarded up for years, but those were boarded up during the trial and the adjudication of the lawsuit. So thank you to Colonel Bergen. Yeah, what a contribution he made to the future of our city. So
I just want to make sure, because you didn't say it, but this wasn't just about Waterbury. This was a landmark historic preservation case that changed the nature of historic preservation in the entire United States.
Wow.
This was it.
Watch
went all the way to the Supreme Court, and it changed the laws. It changed. You can't
just tear down old buildings. It set the precedent that you need to do surveys of those buildings. You need to assess their historic value. And it changed the whole landscape for historic preservation. So this was one of those great Waterbury things that had a huge impact both locally and nationally.
A brief story about Colonel Bergen. He was an infantry officer in Germany and he was part of the Army of Occupation. So during one of our meetings in the 1970s and early 1980s, I asked him, I said, did you ever shoot anybody? And he said, well, you know what, Bob? That's a good question, because he says, I was on guard duty one night. He says, in the war, the Germans had just surrendered. He said, and I saw a man walk out of a building with a rifle in his hand. And he picked up the rifle, and I thought he was pointing it at me. He says, so I drew my weapon, I got him in my sights, and then all of a sudden I realized there was a broom in his hands. He says, so the answer to your question is no. What a wonderful man. What a wonderful man.
I don't want to snatch it too much. The question basically was what has contributed to the demise of downtown? And I think being biblical, without vision of people perish. Sherman mentioned the late Mayor Bergen, the first senior. And Mayor Bergen, back in the 70s, early 70s, prior to Mayor Mambruno, he wouldn't accept any federal money. He didn't want federal money. Sometimes I think he was right. The older I get, I think he was right. But during that same time, there was a couple of proposals which I believe came while he was mayor. One was that the Boise Cascade development, which would have put two twin towers where Croft School is at today, with a civic center in the middle. For some strange reason, Waterbury was way ahead of the curve, but it just did not materialize. Why, I don't know. And I think the second problem that we had that really contributed, even though technology's here, shopping patterns are changing, was a proposal to build the Naugatuck Valley Mall downtown. There was a proposal to build a Naugatuck Valley Mall almost where, I guess, Home Depot is, there, all the way back up to, on one side of the street, under the highway. But there was so much resistance from the Downtown Merchants Association that it never happened. I think that would have been a great, great boon to our city, which would have kept our downtown going a lot longer. I won't debate what happened in New Haven with their Chapel Street Mall, but which went down. Downhill, but we have yielded your support in anyway. Yeah. But I think that we would have been, our downtown would have been more vibrant if a deal could have been made to put that there and protect the other stores.
Okay, well, I'll tell you what, because we're on time to get you involved in this conversation. So I have other questions, but I'd rather hear from you either your remembrances or your thoughts, or if you want to ask any of the panelists a question. So why don't we? Okay.
I'm kind of disappointed no one has talked about the arts in Waterbury and the role in the community. We talked about the civic theater. Until its demise, it's the oldest continually operating community theater in the country. Its demise had
theater teacher, I should be able to do this. Its demise was a combination of things, including what's happened downtown, but also that taking on the cost of the civic theater, which was going to be some kind of a civic center, turned out to be too much for the organization to handle. But if you look at the Manitou Museum, remember when it was across the street, and the fifth grade trips to see Buttons. I mean, that was a fifth grade thing that everybody did. I don't know, they're still doing it. Are they still doing it? Yeah.
She became
But the symphony, the Waterbury Symphony, one of the oldest in the country, and has had a wonderful reputation over the years. 60s, when the green was filled with plays, with theater, with music, with individual artists, its end came when the powers that be decided it needed to go to Library Park. And as soon as it came out of downtown and the center, it lost a lot of audience, it lost a lot of its muscle. But the arts community, the Civic Theater, I remember going to the Civic Theater when I was in the Women's Club, it's now the Salvation Army, on Central Avenue, seeing Rosemary Mondin, John's wife, and George Cohen from Nathan Hale Buick, at the King and I, in the King and I. And it was truly a community theater in so many ways. The arts education in the city was as it was in many places.
Anybody want
to? I just remember the Civic Theater as well, since I worked there for 2 years.
Yes, sure.
Yeah, I remember the Civic Theater distinctly. It was had a wonderful board of directors. The cost of the building was $100,000.
Wow.
A pittance. They went through the theater, the old State Theater, completely restored it. Peter Kellogg on the board, Rocky Ehrenheim and Roberta Ehrenheim, Barbara Davitt, George Francis, Simon Sage Rabazon and his wife, Rose, wonderful people that worked very diligently. Rod Prillick and his wife, Hilda, wonderful people that ran that theater while volunteers tried to make it a go. The mortgage was held by, I believe it was the Waterbury Savings Bank, and they could never generate enough money to pay a $100,000 mortgage, which was really, in the building, I went with the building, hard to believe, because the mechanical systems were so hard to operate. So when the building got sold to Charlie LaFlamme, I was sold with the building. And then when Charlie LaFlamme ran it, I have no idea. I think he sold it for $100,000 as well.
No, but you.
I was part of the deal. In the deed somewhere, I'm sure. Oh, and also the guy, it includes all property, and as well as the guy who knows how to operate it. But seriously, when the building, that building was, of course, lost when it was sold to some unscrupulous, Charlie LaFlamme sold it to another buyer who basically started stealing all the money from ticket sellers. Charlie had turned it into a film theater showing chop sake, what's been referred to as the trade as chop sake movies or kung fu movies, Bruce Lee, you know, Knights of the Dragon and whatever. But you're right, the arts have not been as present as there, but we do have the Palace Theater now, which is also wonderful. It doesn't have the same access to the city citizens. You would think for 40 million we would get a little more free time, but whatever, you know, I'm not
Seven
a dude. Seven Angels is tremendous. That was Danny Calabrese and the rest of the crew out there. Danny was a good friend of mine, a wonderful local artist. But, yeah.
It's all good. Who else would like to?
Ken? I have a question for Mr. Doar. I have heard that at the State Theater, do I need this?
Oh, yeah. No.
I didn't think so. I can project very far.
Thank you. Teachers can do that.
Yes, they can, sir. I have heard that when that theater was put in, it was suspended from the floor up above it by long support rods and not supported underneath it.
That's not true.
That is not true.
No. The actual projection house was built onto the building and supported by cantilevers, but it was the first building.
The theater really was made out of two different theaters. It was called the Polis Theater and the Rialto. And what happened was in 1928, the owners, the RKO Stanley Warner Theater chain, purchased two theaters, and the stage house of the Poli became the stage house of the State Theater. And the actual State Theater auditorium was made by blowing out one wall and then extending the building backwards and then modernizing the interior. In 1974, I was working there, and a man came along in on a bus and truck show. His name was Donald O'Connor. And Donald O'Connor was an old song and dance man. And Donald O'Connor walks in, and I greeted him at the back door with the rest of the performers. It's called the Roy Raiden Vaudeville Review. And Donald walks in, and he looks around, and he said, "Oh my God, I've been here before. I played this theater when I was a kid." And I said, you couldn't have played it. This theater didn't open until 1929. He goes, I've been on this stage with my parents. And come to find out, he was absolutely correct, because that was the stage house of the Poli Theater, built in 1890.
One other quick observation. When Rosalind Russell was here for the opening of her movie at the State Theater, it was the night of the flood of 55. My wife and her mother and father were at that opening. And at the end of the show, they went out to their car, saw the amount of rain, they drove up to Waterville, over the bridge, down to Naugatuck, over the bridge, and then out to Cheshire, where they lived. So they saw this flood.
Well, my father was the MC that night while he came, and legend is that he took a rowboat over to Meadow Street in order to stay on the air for the next 3 days.
I believe it.
That's okay. This question is for Mr. London. I'm curious, sir, if you could speak briefly about the historical presence of police officers in the downtown area.
I didn't hear the beginning.
Could you speak briefly about the historical presence of police officers downtown from your experience?
I never had any contact with them. I can't remember the name of the police who was on duty at the corner of West Main and Leavenworth Street. And that was supposed to be the entry to a promotion to sergeant. And he was there year after year, and he never got promoted to sergeant.
Yeah, we got
Gene Oyer? When I worked in a public school, I was really surprised, this was in another town, that they had basketball games at the schools. And I was like, really? Because one thing that I loved in high school, and it was something that brought everybody together, was basketball games at the Armory. And every now and then, all four schools would play. I don't remember, anybody know the cheer for Croft or Leavenworth? I know Wilby was on the war path. And I know that we used to say to Crosby, stomp the ivy, and the cheerleaders would throw this ivy on the floor and then just stomp on it. And then they would turn around and they would have a heart and they'd go rip the heart, so they'd take the heart and just rip it. And the place was as smoky as anything. And our teachers were the people who sold the tickets. And when all four teams played the same night, nobody left. You had to see both games.
Wow.
Boy, that was really exciting. That was fun. I love that again.
Anyone else? Well, I'll continue, and then as you think.
Can I just add one thing to the police?
Oh.
When I was about 4 or 5, my mother was shopping at the Mohegan. And Mohegan was a market, which is now where directly across from the horse on North Main Street. And the front of it opened up. So there was fruits and vegetables, and you'd go into shop. I was there with her, and then I wasn't. I couldn't find her. So I had been taught that the policeman is my friend. So I walked out to the left and went to the corner, and I tugged on some policeman's jacket and said, my mother is lost. I thought he was going to take me to the police station for an ice cream cone. This is so clear in my head. Instead, he swung me up on his shoulders and said, where did you see your mom last? She was that way. We walked back up North Main Street, and out from Mohegan came my mother, like this, looking for me. But I do remember the Mohegan Market and Reed Biscuit, which was a really good business. Yes, just when you were a kid. That's my policeman story.
And people used to always call way back Waterbury about some officer, I think it was Bill, who was always downtown, walking the beat. And then everyone had to talk about the Peanut Man in Carmel Court. I mean, that was tonight. I do
want to ask, because I don't want us all to wax so nostalgic and not wonder about whether there were things that we don't remember as fondly about downtown, or how well received people might have been coming into the downtown, because it was our gathering place. Reggie, I'll start with you, because you alluded to that. Why was it that downtown was not necessarily the centerpiece that it was for so many,
for the African American?
Well, in our community, as I mentioned earlier, we had everything up there. We had our own housing, we had our own stores. You mentioned Mohegan Market. We had a budget support there across from the old Hendrickson place where Latinos moved into, Puerto Ricans moved into Hendrickson place back in the late 50s, early 60s. We had our own churches. Coming downtown was something very special in our community. You had to come for something. You went to Garson's to get a suit or to the Rose Shop. Other than that, you were in your own community. I don't know if that was good or bad. My recollections of it, simple. I, at 8 years old, I think about it, I had grandchildren twice as old as that, but I would come downtown Waterbury, I come in here, then I go over to the Board of Aldermen, and those old guys in there, they said, where's that black kid doing here, and all the rest of it. But I would go in here, not like I was a lost soul, but I wanted to learn it. And I would do that. I tell my dad, well, I'm going down to the Board of Aldermen. And then I leave here, and I walk up to Orange Street, where we lived off Orange Street. And it was okay. At 8, 9 years old today, my God. And then we would walk, through downtown to go up to Municipal Stadium to play, or the ice skate sometimes when they would flood out there. We'd say, well, we don't want to go to Fulton, let's go to Municipal Stadium. And sometimes, it wasn't really nice, I'll put it that way. There were some very bad epithets thrown at us as kids, especially if we left and went toward Hamilton Park. Many people tell us to get back where we belong, but I never thought we belonged anywhere, so it didn't bother me at all. I just went everywhere I can. And for that lady who mentioned the double headers, don't you really remember when Al Vestro would be up there with smoke everywhere, and kick WATR, and it would intimidate so many teams who came into Waterbury when they would see all of these people, 2,000 people in the armory, and they saw, we have our own a radio station here, and then QQW, whatever they did. So there was competition amongst the radio stations, and after the games, downtown was really, really something else.
Maggie, what do you say?
I think, for us it was a very different experience because we kind of didn't fit in anywhere. But we did, I mean, there's always race relations issues, right? I can't believe what's happening now in our country because we didn't feel it as much. Obviously, like I said, we came up in 78, 79, but to us, and somebody has said earlier about people that are not from Waterbury not understanding, you know, when you're, because I consider myself from Waterbury, right? Because it was. It's just such a melting pot. And even though at the end of the day, we kind of went to their separate corners of the city, even still, then, like you said, we knew each other. We, you know, went to school, and little by little, you know, we kind of learned from each other and assimilated to each other
let me ask, to continue along that theme, I mentioned about the contrast between what people outside of Waterbury versus those who lived here think about the city and the perception being so different. I'll never forget that everybody would say to me when I was at Connecticut Television, oh, you must have grown up in West Hartford. You know, a Jewish kid in media, you must be from West Hartford. And I said, no, I came from Waterbury. And they were like, really? You're programming Connecticut Public Television? And then Charlie Monaghan, the editor of Connecticut Magazine, he's a Waterbury guy, running two of the most effete media organizations in the state. It's pretty pretty interesting. But what is the contrast, I mean, that we're talking about here between what we knew, and look at the panel and how articulate and thoughtful. I mean, why is it that people have this perception of Waterbury? And maybe, Reggie, you want to talk about the political leadership in the city, because that has an impact on the progressive notion of downtown and the entire community.
I, first of all, just want to say you're absolutely right. You hit the nail on the head. Everyone hates us. Everyone hates Waterbury. Why? I don't know. I mean, we were so culturally diverse. One of my favorite memories is calling WATR, winning a loaf of Italiano bread. I answered something on here, and I was so happy. I called WATR. I got it. But, you know, I was like in eighth grade. But when I got to UConn, it was interesting. I knew records and songs and performers that other black kids did not know, because they were so segregated in listening and in their own communities. Hartford kids listened to WKND, which was a black radio station. New Haven kids listened. So they had no idea when Chicago came, when they were the Chicago Transit Authority, that I wanted to be there, and I went there, and they really yelled at me until the next year when Chicago changed their name from CTA to Chicago. Oh, they're pretty cool now. I said, I told you that over a year ago. But here in Waterbury, we knew differences. You know, we used to listen to the Zabruski show. Now here we are, black kids. Here we are, black kids, and on Sunday morning it would be on WATR, and my dad would get up, and prior to going, get ready for church and all the rest, we would listen to the Polish Eagles show, and then we would turn to the black gospel that came on. But we embraced all of this here in Waterbury, and they hate us for a few reasons. I served 20 years in the state legislature, and when John Rowland got elected, it was like, oh, the whole world's going to change because he's here. No, no, no. Everyone forgot when Mescal was elected in New Britain, New Britain changed. The highways came through, got new courthouses and all that. So they hated everything about us. We still can't put our fingers on it. But one thing they did not like was the unity in our delegation. We're Republicans. We had Tim Upson and Steve Soma at one point, and then all Democrats in the House. We all got together. We all met together. We all would go out and eat, and we would have a great time together. So we have something special and unique in Waterbury, and hopefully it will not change.
Oh, I believe that.
I will say, I have actually found editorials in the Hartford Current from the 1800s slamming Waterbury. So it goes back really far. And it's just, we've got some bad publicity. But you know, just to put it on an upbeat tone, it may be other parts of Connecticut that are down on Waterbury, but when people come here who aren't from Connecticut, when someone comes here from Seattle or Texas, they think that Waterbury is amazing. So it's just Connecticut.
I'd like to say one thing about the arts, and that is that for a long time, they were very self-protective. So the library didn't necessarily want to do something with the museum. A museum didn't necessarily want to do anything with the symphony orchestra. And so they all lived in their own little worlds. And then, beginning with something like the Big Read that came into Waterbury, that brought together all the schools and all of these art venues, it began to change. And you can see that collaboration now with the Palace putting on Phantom of the Opera and the museum showing costumes from that period, the Phantom of the Opera set, and the film being shown at the Waterbury Symphony when it plays the music, when it gives its concert on this coming Sunday. So it's everyone working together, which I think is a healthy thing.
Can I point out that the Big Read was sponsored by the National Endowment for the Humanities?
I have one question. I'm good enough for you with the answer. When we were young, on 4th of July, they had a massive
comments on that next week as part of our futures. But I want to ask you, Sean, because being at the Republican American and the Hartford Current, the Haven Register, what do you think about the reporting of Waterbury, outside of Waterbury, and the reputation of Waterbury?
Well, all of the newspaper, well, they weren't editors, they were all reporters, just sort of looked down on our political system, and they didn't think much of us. The only one thing that they granted me, there were a half a dozen of us who had to write columns for the Sunday paper, and used to write them Saturday for the Sunday paper. And we'd be talking, and what are you going to write about? Oh, I don't know, I haven't thought of anything. And they'd turn to me and say, you've always got something to write about in Waterbury's politics. And I did.
Isn't it appropriate that we're all here on Thursday night? Because Thursday night was Waterbury Downtown's special Thursday night.
Sure was.
Anyone else have anything that you'd like to say before we kind of break up and just talk among ourselves? Yes.
I just want to say that I lived on Wall Street in a 10-family block, and I was only 9 years old, so I can just say that my mother would send me downtown to Rose Shop to pay $2 on a bill every Saturday, and the highlight was to stop at Presky's and watch the donut machine go around.
All right. There, we're coming to that whole circle. Well, I just want to thank this wonderful panel, and I want to thank, of course, the Silas Bronson Library, Connecticut Humanities, UConn, and all that they have done to make this program possible. I do want to mention that as part of this, we decided to post a number of old, way back Waterbury programs going back to 2002, and I believe Bob Holzer will be on that one, who was a wonderful representative for the city at WATR. So if you go up on Shape of Sox, S-O-X, we're talking about Red Sox, shapeofsox.com, it'll be posted tomorrow, a number of old Wayback Waterbury segments. So if you miss some of the things that we talked about tonight and want to hear even more, go up on that site and you'll have a whole cornucopia of them. But again, I want to thank everyone tonight for coming, and please come back next Thursday night, same time, same place. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And there's still some Diorios left, and there's flyers if you want to post them around anywhere.
I'm all set.